discovered by Scotsmen. They are a country bigger than three Great Britains, but they're almost entirely full of deep forests and rocky mountains. They wanted the first Scottish expedition, part of history, to do the first ever water journey from the northern border, 2,000 miles from the Yukon to the United States. Nine interlocking rivers, including the roughest rivers in the world. I was told that I would lead it because I was on the Army Reserve, in which case the Army would give me a free Land Rover BER. I discovered later that meant beyond economical repair. I went to the barracks in Edinburgh to choose the best Scotsman out of 600. I found a fine one called Joseph Skavinsky, and the three of them were given a total of 6 weeks' leave. We took 8 months, so they were not popular when they got back. The reason for this was because none of us had been on bad water ever before, and yet the Ministry of Defence only gave us training permission on the Thames at Henley. So when we got to Canada, our learning curve was very steep. The opposite to training, really. We had four boats with three people in each boat. On one rapid, we had a 28-foot-high standing wave, and one of our boats was flipped over. We found their bodies a mile down the stream, and that would have stopped the entire expedition. But luckily, it was just the BBC film crew. Round about 1972, we found we couldn't get sponsorship because the media only wanted cold expeditions. So we had to switch from doing hot expeditions, which we liked, to doing polar ones. Now, at breakfast, Ginny decided what we must do to get into the polar field, not just North Pole, South Pole. She decided we would do the first ever circumnavigation, 52,000 miles without flying 1 meter, crossing the whole of the Arctic and the Antarctic. I got sent to a library to find out the best route. I discovered there was a white bit at the bottom called Antarctica, which had never been crossed from one side to the other by experts. Up at the top, as you can't see, another problem, 2,500 miles of floating ice over the North Pole. Then you've got the Northwest Passage and Sahara and other problems. So I went home and I told my wife it was a stupid idea. She became quite unpleasant. So I therefore went back to the library. The only route which was sensible was the one from Greenwich, Game Zero, round the world, 180 on the other side. We spent 7 years getting sponsors. We had 1,900 sponsor companies. We had to have an office. The SAS gave us a rifle range in Sloane Square. We'd obviously forgotten what I'd been up to previously. And we got the sponsorship. We wanted at least two other blokes who would be going with me for 3.5 years slowly around the world. We had 800 applicants, people like you, be prepared to work on a project for 4 years without pay. Out of 800, we chose one who had been a Whitbread beer salesman in London for 9 years. The other one, South African, did butcher's business in Cape Town, went bust, so he joined the British Army. And those two. Their characters were right. You can't change character, you can teach skills. We eventually got everything together, got a sponsorship. They took us down, and as I say, the people on the ship, chief engineers from New Zealand, Fiji, all over the world, given up their jobs with P&O for 4 years unpaid. They dropped the land group off on the Greenwich Meridian in Antarctica. Unloading is a problem because if you get the wind gets up, the ice breaks and you lose everything. The ship then went round to the other side of the world to New Zealand and waited for 18 months. No polar satellites, no GPS, no sat-nav, no sat phone. We were for navigation using Greenwich on one watch and local on the other and the position of the sun. Same as it was for Scott and Shackleton. Things hadn't progressed by then. The ship went away and waited on the other side. We moved from the coastline past the hinge zone with crevasses, 400 miles inland to 12,000 feet above sea level to the last known feature on Earth, that rock, Rivingen. From that point, for 900 miles to the South Pole, was unknown, unexplored, unmapped. Nobody knew how high it was, totally unexplored. But before we could go into the unknown zone, we had to live for 8 months. Because you can't travel in Antarctica in winter then or now, not allowed to apart from anything else. Ginny in Scotland designed paper cardboard houses. They're very light, easy to erect. We did that, but they are only insulated to minus 30. We recorded wind chill minus 122 degrees. They can withstand 40 mile an hour winds. We reported 166 miles an hour. So you might think we got blown over and cold, but she designed them so that snow came up to that level, giving you insulation and protection, but then you cannot get out. You might say, well, why would you want to get out? And the answer is, we were cooking with gasoline in a paper house. In the UK, we've been unable to practice crossing crevasses. There's luckily just outside the hut one opened up, which gave us training permission. Basically, we will be using Canadian skis with a 14-inch ski and 4 5-inch wheels to tow sledges. Normally, as you know, you can't see the crevasses, it's just white. If you want to know where they are, you tread on them and fall into them, and then you know where they were. 8 months of darkness, then the sun came back. The thermometer rose to minus 68, so we set out into the unknown. We said goodbye to the base commander. That is the worst job of all. That's why I gave it to Ginny, because I don't think that'd be her fault for thinking of it. Unfortunately, she was a little person and couldn't roll 45-gallon drums about, so a man had to be living with my wife for 3 years. So I did not want somebody physically attractive in that position. Luckily, we found a Yorkshireman for that. We did the first ever crossing of the entire unexplored zone. We mapped it for the first time using aneroid barometers. Our tent weighed 120 pounds. Today it weighs 3 pounds. Up there we have katabatic wind that goes from 0 to 100 miles an hour in under half a minute. Don't give you long to fiddle about with your tent pegs. We therefore used the best tent ever designed in Greenock up in Scotland, basically in 1908 by the world's greatest polar explorer of all time, who today is more lied about than anybody else. I'm talking about Captain Scott. We did the first ever crossing of the entire continent, bigger than China and India. When we arrived at the Pacific coast, you know that you're there because there is only one active volcano on the entire continent. 2 days before we got there, the first tourist to Antarctica by air arrived, crashed into the volcano, 160 dead, no way of removing their bodies. But from here, we could see that we had completed the first ever crossing of the continent. When Ginny planned all this 9 years before, she did it on her 6-inch school globe with a crayon, so her planning was not precise. But well, she reckoned if we came out to the other side, that's just floating sea ice, we'd send a Morse code message to the ship in New Zealand, they would try to get through. That year, two other ships bigger than ours sunk in the ice. Ours did get through, collected us, and took us up the other side. Still the same crew, still unpaid, I believe. And two of them were dead, but the rest were okay. Moved up to Los Angeles, Vancouver, through the Bering Straits. That's the Greenwich Meridian, 180, North Pole, 500 miles north of Canada. You might think if we had a ship that was ice strengthened, 40 years old, we would just go into the Arctic Sea, over the pole, and down to Greenland. That's fine if it's a nuclear icebreaker. Otherwise, you go in there, you've got 3 million ton flows of ice moving at 4 miles an hour. And if two of them hit each other, your ship will sink. Therefore, when she planned all this 9 years earlier, she decided the ship would drop the three of us off in 12-foot rubber boats at the mouth of the Yukon River. The ship would go for a year around the Panama and wait. We would then go 1,200 miles up the Yukon River, 800 miles down the Mackenzie River, change to a 16-foot open plastic boat, and try to do the first one-year traverse for 2,000 miles of the Northwest Passage, and then 900 miles to the edge of the world, where we would wait for 8 months of darkness before doing the 2,500-mile crossing. That was her plan. She gave us 2 months to get from the mouth of the Yukon up to there. When we got there, we discovered that only three expeditions in history had ever been through the Northwest Passage bit, and they'd taken an average of 3 years. I am not making a comment on female planning, but they do need to be watched. No problem on the Yukon River, except unfortunately there were only two of us, not three, because 9 years of his life unpaid, Ollie the beer salesman was threatened with divorce if he didn't leave the expedition. So Charlie and I carried on. The Northwest, I showed you a map, 2,000 miles of the passage over Canada, call that the Canadian coastline. 500 miles away, North Pole, all the ice has been sent against the coast, so very often, even in midsummer, you can't get through. We were lucky, there was a big storm, took the ice away, and 7 days and nights we got through. But at the other end, it began to freeze. That's called grease ice. After 2 hours with no wind, it will congeal to sugar porridge ice, and then the boat will actually freeze in, which is what happened. 11 years later, it unfroze, and the Canadian Coast Guard rescued it. We didn't know that at the time. The two of us had now to try and ski or snowshoe, which we had not planned, 400 miles over the unmapped area of Ellesmere Island. The other guy, Charlie, on the left there, South Africa, basically in the boat, one of his feet got waterlogged and the skin fell off, leaving raw nerves under one foot. 400 miles on snowshoes, very uncomfortable, his language got very bad. He then developed hemorrhoids and it got worse. Then one day he fell over and he cracked his head on a rock and his eyes filled up with blood. He started to whinge. I've got a picture of his better foot at that point. We eventually made it to the edge of the world. There were two abandoned huts and we lived there for 8 weeks of darkness. Me and Charlie and Ginny, and I have to say, a dog with a pain in the neck, the Jack Russell, called Buffy. It later became Pet of the Year in the UK and was in the Guinness Book of Records as the only dog ever to have peed on both poles. We set out in the dark, we said goodbye to Ginny, 2,500 miles to go. 5 months going over, surf in the dark, that's steam at minus 50, water freezes at minus 2, we've got a lot of movement. We reached the North Pole after 3.5 months, in a very bad way physically. We put a flag there, as I mentioned earlier on, but within an hour, the flag is a mile away from the pole, so it's pretty stupid. You want to keep going there, you want to put the flag there, swim down 17,000 feet to the seabed, put your flag there, and it will stay put. We unfortunately had a very bad argument between us because we didn't know which direction was Greenwich, because everything on the compass was south at that point. We wanted to go 1,800 miles. People go to the North Pole today, helicopter out before the big breakup. We couldn't, we had a long way to go. Instead of getting 1,800 miles to where the ship might rescue us, we only got 380 before the breakup. Very frightening. We found a floe 8 foot deep on the hand drill, put the tent up. Every time a new crack came, we moved the tent. We sat there for weeks and months. Charlie had a solar panel, which gave us enough power to listen to the BBC World Service for 2 minutes a day, if there was reception. And I can remember one day with his headset on, Charlie said, "The United Kingdom is at war." So I said, "Who with?" He said, "Oh, I didn't get that bit." We sat for 5 days, a bad radio reception, arguing who the hell we could get war with. Obviously, we assumed it was France, but we had like... And they said it was Argentina. We thought that was just a stupid BBC joke. We did not get bored because we got visits 600 miles from any people. You hear them just outside the tent. They weigh 1.5 tons. We had been promised by the Canadian government that Canadian polar bears, only 10% of them actually eat humans. But when they're outside the tent, you're going to ask them which percent. Our main worry was not the bears, it was the fact that we were being sucked and our ice was breaking up. We sent a Morse code message to Southampton. Ship came 2 months earlier than planned, cracked the hull open and started to sink. Cleverly, they rammed ice so that the hull was in the air and had to go for 2 months back to Svalbard. We panicked. Luckily, 4 years before, Ginny had designed canoes with skis. We were too weak to get into the canoes. The ice could move at 4 miles an hour. You didn't want to get crushed. Cut a long story short, the ship tried 4 times to get near us. Eventually, it got further north than any other ship. We'd been out on the ice for 8 months. We got on the ship. At that time, human beings, for the first time in history, had been around Earth vertically. Nobody has ever done it again since. More people have been on the moon. We kept our team together, and in the 80s and 90s, we broke all world records of unsupported polar travel against our main enemies, the Norwegians, up in the north and the south. We developed with British Aerospace the technology where we could carry 400 pounds over NILAS, you went over there, you go straight through, go ahead at 4 miles an hour. Sugar, nearly forming, we were able, without heavy amphibious gear, apart from paddles, to go over that. The Norwegians still could not. We used political lateral thought, 1992, Gorbachev perestroika. I wrote dinners to Gorbachev, I lead the first Western expedition from Siberia. In Moscow, that's a big blow. That's the North Pole, 500 miles Siberian coast. There is one particular point where you can set out from, Messner had set out from it just before. The next day he was washed away on ice. I think his brother might have been with him. They were very lucky they got rescued, but the lady from France did not. We were told we could set out from Arkchichisky, but it was also a secret Soviet missile base, so I had to sign a contract that I would take no photos while there. I did not, the other members of the team did. We broke all records from Siberia for the next 9 years, but back in the UK, I discovered that the Americans, which is very annoying, were trying to find the lost city in Arabia, which by then, Ginny and I had been looking for 26 years. 8 major four-wheel drive expeditions, and we were about to find it. So having NASA getting in on the act was very annoying. They put the camera on the shuttle. They fly to 170 kilometers, and they take photographs of the deserts. Yeah, that's a NASA professor. That is the Great Desert. 80 miles between each sand dune feature, Saudi Arabia, Indian Ocean. NASA knew that the lost city that we'd been looking for all that time was out there deep in the sand dunes, because the NASA professor looked at the shuttle photo through bioptics and they can see the outline of the lost city 30 feet under the sand. It's called cheating. And they knew it was at right angles, therefore it must be a lost city, because only people would make things with right angles. Well, I got sponsored by Land Rover very quickly. We went 300 miles into the sand dunes to the NASA site, which we discovered by WikiLeaks. We got there 8 months before they mounted their own expedition, and my archaeologist, the best in the world, Dr. Zarin, took one look at the NASA site, and he said, this is not the lost city, this is a place made by God using right angles in order to fool NASA. We reverted to traditional archaeology, and we discovered the long lost city. Some of you may have seen it. It's the biggest excavation works now in Arabia. Just to end up with, because I'm running out of time, this was drawn in 1910 by Shackleton. He planned to cross Antarctica. His ship would make 4 of them land there, go to the pole, name them, and die of hunger. Therefore, 2 years earlier, Shackleton's other expedition would drop food off here. That was the plan. As you know, the ship sunk, so he never set out. Couldn't tell this lot, so they did set out. Got killed and didn't drop the food off, so if he had reached the pole, he would have died anyway, but it was a good plan. It was copied 30 years after his death by Ed Hillary, Kleiner, and Fuchs, the top scientific man. Pincer movement of 2 big national expeditions on the Shackleton plan. So, in 1990s, when I'm talking about, only 4 of us had ever crossed Antarctica. The blue line was my wife's round the world. Americans, 1990. Diagonal, Hillary and Fuchs in the 50s. Lastly, the greatest mountaineer in the world, Ranulph Messner from Italy, together with Arvid Fuchs, Germany's top polar man, did that crossing there. None of us did it without their support. Now, 1992, our intelligence unit in Aberdeen, they have 80-foot radio masts in their vegetable patch to listen in to the Norwegians, to know what they are planning before we, so we can get there first. We heard that they were trying in 1991-2 to do the first ever crossing of the whole of Antarctica's continent without supply. So what you carry on day one, which will be 500 pounds, will last you for 2,000 miles, including heat for minus 50. We thought it was impossible calorifically, but you can't let your rivals do it without trying. So we caught an aeroplane to Antarctica's biggest airport, that's the control tower. We flew 1,900 miles to the start point. which is where the Atlantic hits Antarctica, 100 miles away on the edge the Norwegians set out on the same day. Our team consisted of myself and Europe's number one physiologist, specializing in studying the effects of starvation on the human body, the element on this expedition, Dr. Michael Straub, 500 pounds each. He scientifically monitored our output calorifically, which was 9,500 calories a day. If you run a marathon, you might lose 2,500. We got skeletal rapidly. We could only carry 5,000 calories a day. I set out at 15.5 stone. By the halfway point of the pole, I was under 9 stone, despite eating 5,000 calories a day. Even weight watchers would not recommend it. You can't wear Gore-Tex or polar fleece like normal. You have to wear ventile cotton, 100% breathable, or you'll get hypothermia. Basically, towing 500 pounds at minus 50, you sweat. As soon as you stop wearing, you get cold very rapidly indeed. You can't wear normal soft boots to protect your feet. You have to wear downhill rigid boots to dig the skins in, otherwise you won't move that 500 pounds, 1 meter, never mind the entire distance. That is what happens to your toes. That's after 10 days. Very painful for an hour, then they get cold and stop hurting. That's after 3 weeks. We knew we would have skin grafts after 3 months. Sydney, ozone hole, skin cancer. Much worse down there. You're under the hole. You must cover your skin. So remember, you are towing on a dog harness. You breathe like hell. You can't cover up your lips. Therefore, in the tent at night, when you sleep, your lips close together. They get stuck with the scabs. Wake up in the morning. The first thing you do, as you know, is to share porridge out of a common little bowl. So you have to pull your lips apart, get rid of the scabs. All your blood goes in his porridge, which causes perforations. Being explorers, you will know what time it is on his watch. He's heading for the South Pole. The sun is due north at midday, so it must be midday on his watch if he's treading on his shadow. That was how we navigated in those days before GPS. I took a photo of the crevasse because normally you can't see them. With that one you could. That is why I developed a very careful policy, which is to watch the bloke ahead. Nobody's going to fall into that one. You can actually see the hole up top there. At the South Pole, the Norwegians dropped out, pretty much dead. The only reason we carried on, and we're in a very bad way physically and mentally, was because Dr. Michael Straub had a contract with the Lancet medical magazine on the topic of advanced starvation. And at the pole, he weighed us and found that we were starving even more than he had hoped. And he got determined to complete the article, even if it was posthumous. We did the first ever descent of the Beardmore Glacier 9,000 feet without crampons. We lost them. I began to hate him. I've done 25 years of expeditions of descents, including next year, but every 5 days he took your blood, didn't have much blood left for his science. Every 8 days he made you drink a container of liquid costing $1,000, and for 24 hours after you drink it, any liquid coming out of your body has to be collected in his bottles or you're in trouble, especially urine. And I have to say, peeing outside in a wind at minus 90 wind chill is dangerous to fill a pee bottle if you are male, although obviously at that temperature the difference between males and females is not great. His hands got bad, the blisters fall off. A little bit later I made a problem. 5 months later I had to have the top half of all those fingers amputated, but it was only a 3-minute mistake. Mike and I reached the far side of the continent, that was the Pacific coastline, having completed the first ever crossing unsupported of the entire continent. Today the longest unsupported polar journey in history. Back in Europe, we completed, for science, 19 muscle biopsies without anaesthetic. Very painful. I enjoyed taking that photo of mine. We raised the sum of 4.2 million from that expedition. Altogether, as of last year, our expeditions have raised 18.2 million. Hopefully next year we'll get another 3 million from Marie Curie. All the expeditions are based on a charity and a science program. But from my point of view, as I think I mentioned, it's my profession, and that's what I do it for, and I need sponsorship. And to get sponsorship, we need to continue to beat all our international known rivals at all times. You've got time for